So coming to BNR 101, then activated sludge. Well, this is what I'd like to talk about. Activated sludge and BNR basics, controls, plant hydraulics, carbon management, etc. And then I'll talk a little bit about new developments like granular activated sludge, anemox ice stream treatment, and the fate of carcinogens and so forth in wastewater, in what happens in the activated sludge plant. Now, for those that don't really know very much about the process, this is what we do in the activated sludge. We simply, well, first, mostly we settle whatever will settle out in the primary tanks, and then we go through an aeration step and then settle the sludge, the biomass, and return that so that we can grow a mass of biosolids that can do the job. So the aerobic organisms, the heterotrophs, they break down the sugars and protein and starches that would otherwise rot and stink, and produce CO2 and water while releasing the ammonia and phosphate. And well, there's some growth in here, so always excess biomass must be wasted. And here is what the picture looked like. We have primary tanks. This is a BNR plant partitioned to do the various things that I'm going to talk about now, and the settling tanks. So in order to understand what is at issue for us, especially with nitrification, is when we look at the contribution of all the various parts of constituents of the wastewater, the most of the production of biomass is done by the sugar wastes, the proteins and things like that. The nitrifiers that turn the ammonia to nitrites, only a very small fraction of it. But they are slower growers, so they determine what the size is. So if we have this biomass here in that aeration basin, in that tank, and we say the sludge is going to grow, the biomass is going to grow by that much, so we must waste that much every day to keep it in balance. So the amount that we waste divided into the mass here, that we refer to as the sludge age or the solids retention time. And that is very important, because the longer that is, the longer you have contact between the wastewater and the organisms. So even if we increase the ammonia in the plant, we don't really increase the size of the plant, because it just means that you go from maybe 5 to 10%. The first of all then, what is this nitrification? Nitrification is the conversion of ammonia to nitrate and nitrite and nitrate. And these are done by slow-growing organisms. They are very sensitive, strictly aerobic, autotrophic, which means they use carbon dioxide as their basic building block. So it takes them longer to grow. And so they require a longer sludge age. When we can wash them out, they're influenced by temperature, by pH and all that. So what we see here is the full cycle. And what's interesting to look at is most of our nitrogen fertilizer today is produced by the Haber-Posch process, which is very, very energy intensive. So about 3% of all the energy in the world goes into just the manufacture of fertilizer, about 97% of our fertilizer. So then we are at the ammonia stage, and that is when we break down the proteins, we have the ammonia, then we have to spend a lot of energy to convert that to nitrite, and then more energy to get it to nitrate, and then more energy in the form of carbon for denitrification, which I'll come to in a minute. So you can see this is a very energy intensive cycle. And what's inside here, I'll talk about later, but these are shortcut methods to remove nitrogen from wastewater. So if I can sum up then, the conversion of ammonia to nitrates, well, one of the reasons, of course, ammonia is toxic to fish in the effluent. It uses up oxygen in the receiving water. We want to remove that, and it serves as a fertilizer for the growth of algae. Slow growing, they actually produce acid, so they eat up the alkalinity. So for each 1 milligram per liter of ammonia that we convert as nitrogen, we destroy 7.5 milligram per liter of alkalinity. And we have to keep them in the system. As I said, they only make up 5% of it. Now here, what I've shown, don't pay too much attention to that. It's just how we adjust for the temperature. Designing in colder climates, then the tanks are bigger because we need more longer time to get the nitrifiers to grow. And then, of course, the alkalinity is consumed. But, of course, a lot of the ammonia is actually tied up in the surplus biomass, which, when we digest that, causes a return stream of ammonia coming back to the plant. So what is denitrification? Now, denitrification is a totally separate thing from nitrification, because that is done by a group of organisms that are actually just breaking down or normal carbon compounds. And they will use oxygen. They would prefer to use oxygen as electron acceptor. But if they don't find oxygen, they'll use nitrate. And they reduce the nitrate to the nitrogen gas. And so we can get that level of nitrogen down from, say, 30 to 2 milligram per liter just by switching off air at certain places and feed nitrates. And the nitrates will be destroyed. Now we can do that in separate basins, but I've made this demonstration here to show what happens during denitrification. Say we have a sugar waste, we have the bacteria, and we get carbon dioxide and water, and it uses oxygen. So now we add nitrate and remove the oxygen, and we get nitrogen gas, but this reaction is still the same. And that's why it's really called anaerobic respiration. But we just refer to that as anoxic conditions. I remember having an argument with a microbiologist once, and he said, anoxic, anaerobic, it means the same. I said, yes, for you, but not for us. So we make that distinction. So what we can do is we can have a plant with a longer SRT that would nitrify. And in many cases, we would need to add alkalinity because of the production of acid. And we would have to add alkalinity. And if we add, in order to that the pH don't drop, because that would affect the nitrification rate. But if we then going to do a separate denitrification step, and this is actually what is happening or was the intention, sorry, of the plant in Washington. The Blue Plains plant. But then we need a carbon source to break down the nitrates in order to feed those organisms so that they can take the nitrates to nitrogen gas. So what the MLE process, or as I called it at first, the MBE process, and this is the first one of its kind in the lab, what that does is say, let's say the nitrification takes place in there. Let's recycle those nitrates back to the front, switch off the air on that front end. There we have the carbon coming in. So now we can use the influent carbon for denitrification. And this will bring it down to 6 to 12 milligram per liter total nitrogen through this process of nitrification, denitrification here. Or going to 4 stages in which we add a second anoxic zone to which we can optionally add carbon. So in warmer climates, we find just with the 4 stages, we can get the nitrogen down to quite low levels. But in colder climates, we have to add some carbon there. And we can get this down to like a total of 3 milligram per liter. That is about the limit that we're looking at the present time. So the nitrogen removal performance is then linked to the COD. COD is a measure of the strength of the wastewater of the carbonaceous material to the total nitrogen, which is referred to as total caldol nitrogen. That's the total nitrogen in the influent. And reduce the dissolved oxygen. So we was trying to limit the dissolved oxygen in these anoxic zones. The rate of recycle, that is also important in the design. Temperature affecting both nitrification and denitrification. The SRT, we need to get nitrification, and then the pH and alkalinity and load variation. So the advantages of denitrification when you do it simultaneously is that you reduce the total nitrogen in the effluent, number one, obviously. In combined nitrification, denitrifications, there's a saving in energy because we don't need energy now to break down the carbonaceous material because the nitrates can do that. It restores alkalinity, so we use 7.5 to form nitrates, but if we reduce it in the same process, we get 3.5 back. And that makes it possible then in many plants not to have to add any alkalinity to them. It prevents denitrification in the final clarifiers because that was another issue, especially in warmer climates. The nitrates go into the clarifiers and then it starts denitrifying there, and the gas lifts the sludge up, and it overall just results in a lot more stable operation. Now here, another issue that we have to deal with is this scum foam formation. And you can deal with that very easily by simply making sure that you wash it out of the system all the time. Now, in here, for instance, what we are doing, and we're moving towards this more now, is instead of wasting this thicker sludge here, we waste a thinner sludge from up there. If we waste that sludge from up there, it's very easy to determine what that solid retention time is. Because the solid retention time is this mass of solids we have in here divided by the mass that we waste per day. And then we express that as days. So typically we would have, say, I think I'll come back to that again. An HRT is the hydraulic retention time in a tank, maybe, say, 12 hours or so. But depending on how cold it is, the solid retention time, because we keep recycling the solids, could be in the order of, say, 10 to 14 days. Now, in this case, this is an interesting one because we designed this plant like this. So the operator doesn't have to watch. He doesn't have to make any further calculations. He just looks at the volume that he wastes. If this volume is a tenth of that volume, then it's a 10-day SRT, sludge retention time. And you waste all the lighter sludge and all the scum. Now, this is interesting because we designed this plant and you see no scum on the plant here like this. But somebody, I can see this on Google Earth. Sometimes I use Google Earth to go back and look at plants that I've designed. And I can, on Google Earth, I could see the scum on that, which was so huge. Because they probably thought, well, there's no scum on the plant, so, you know, probably we don't need this. And then what happens is you keep recycling the sludge, the scum, and then it grows like that. So there are some things about common operating changes that you can adjust in the plants. We'll not go into this further. But also a tendency if you have the SRT too long. So we want that SRT just long enough to get the nitrifiers to grow. If it's too long, then we start growing like this. Now this plant was clear, there was no scum on it. And then came, and I told them to waste, this is Hong Kong, I told them to waste the sludge regularly. But then Chinese New Year came in, and after Chinese New Year, it looked like this.